Hello everybody and welcome to this tutorial. Today we're gonna just continue on as this is a follow-up tutorial. So without further ado, let me just show the modifications that I've made to the SQL map command. I have it here somewhere. Yep, there we go. So the address is pretty much the same as it was, except there is this bar thing at the end. It was in the address of the site. I've removed it. I have literally no idea why, but it's supposed to be there. I'm sorry for that. Anyway, in the cookie section, you will also need to make some modifications. So this is the cookie that we have previously used. I have closed and reopened the session since then, so it is likely that this has changed. But you will need to identify the cookie. So it's PHP SE SSID. This is the type of cookie that we have picked up. So just type it in. And you can also specify the security level equals, and then you specify it here. Oops, it's low. Sorry, let me just change that quickly. Excellent, there we go. So I've been playing around with it, and I've been trying to see what happens with different sort of settings. And you see, just to confirm on the website, DVA security, it is on high. So you see the setting here is on high. However, you can, even though the setting is on high here, you can play around with these cookies. And you can do this on any other site pretty much. You can also modify the cookies to get different sort of results. So instead, if it's high here, and even though the site is set to high, I can type in here low. And it's gonna go as low, no problems. Now, this is not, as I said, this is not something that you can apply here and here alone. This can be applied pretty much anywhere. Open up your burp suit, take a look at the cookie section, and see what happens there. See the, try logging in and out of the website, wiping your cookies clean, wiping your browser history clean, and see, like, have five consecutive cookies and see what happens. Or log in through a different browser or log in through a different virtual machine and just have, or five or something like that, consecutive complete cookies, and then see how they change. If you can figure out their rates of change and if you can figure out how they're assigned, well, there you go. You need nothing else pretty much. However, that is not really likely to happen unless somebody has some really bad cookie keys, that then you can do pretty much whatever you want. Let's just change this to high again. And if I already have it cached, I've done it several times, but if it doesn't work with high, leave the high setting on the website, but modify the cookie to low and trick it in such a fashion. I have a bad feeling it's going to pull it from cache, and it did pull it from cache. It doesn't really matter. Yours is just going to take a bit longer, maybe like 30 seconds more or something like that, and you'll probably be prompted with a question. Read through the question. It will offer, if it finds some vulnerabilities, it will stop and it will ask you, do you want to continue scanning even though I found vulnerabilities? You can say either no or yes, just type in N or Y. For the time being, if you wish to follow exactly through this tutorial, you can just answer with no because we are focusing on a particular vulnerability and we're not expanding on it. But on your own, I would strongly recommend that you do keep on scanning and try out different stuff. And as I said, if it doesn't exactly work with high, just try modifying cookies to low and leave it on the site as high. Anyway, so we have some information here. We can go ahead and read through it. It says parameter ID get, type boolean, base blind, title, it says payloads. Excellent. So type union query. Okay, so this is definitely vulnerable, and this, all this information that tells you is, tells you a bit about the vulnerability, and it confirms that it is vulnerable, but you still need to actually do something with it. You still need to try to extract information. By the way, your log files are here. You see this file that I'm selecting. Do not forget to type in the dot here, the one that I'm selecting now. So just type in slash root dot SQL map slash output slash, and this is my current IP address, but you know, IP addresses vary from one web server to another. So just use the one that is written out here for in order to access the logs. There will be all sorts of files there, but you can just go ahead and use the file named quite literally log, open it up and see what's written in it. Basically, you will have this here in it, no problems. Anyway, now that we've established that it is vulnerable, I have a few commands here that I have written out for myself. Yep, there we go. So let's just go ahead and clear the screen now. We know that it is vulnerable. We're going to use pretty much exactly the same syntax. However, we want to add a few things. So DBS. Let's see how this works out. Unable to retrieve the database names. Falling back to the current database. Fetching database name, something wrong with the full union technique, could not because of the limitation. Okay, let's try tricking the website from high to low. And there we go. It's right there. So once again, I see I've just modified the cookies themselves. I haven't actually modified the site. If I go back to the site, if I click on security, it is on high. You see, this has not changed at all. I'll just go back to the SQL injection blind. Go ahead and open up the terminal. And it says here available databases. So we have DVWA, information scheme, MySQL, preference scheme, and so on and so forth. Oops, there we go. So if we open up, if we just go back to our command, we can type in D for database, and now we can retrieve tables from individual databases. By the way, the DBS just lists the just gives you the databases basically. It says available databases and the ones that you want to access depending on what sort of information is contained where. You can't, of course, know, but it doesn't really hurt just to check them out. Sometimes there is a lot of them and it can be a drag, but it doesn't matter. As soon as you get to this part, as soon as you manage to go through the first barrier and actually access their database remotely, you're there. Then it's just a matter of time, far less time, primarily because you are able to go through those databases and figure out what is where. Now, if somebody's keeping an active track of what is going on, and if somebody's monitoring this live, they will be able to see that that there is an incoming connection. That can be problematic because they can kick you off, but so what? If you do this at some ridiculous hours of the morning, depending on in which time zone the database is, you can actually pull the databases, just download them, and then analyze them later. So you have all the time in the world to analyze them after you have pulled them, after you've pulled the information, and after you've seen. Then you can just sit back, relax, disconnect your machine, and without and risk-free, basically, just go through the files and see what is contained therein. Now I have immediately written here DVWA, but let's just go through some of the other ones as well. Let's see what's in there. SQL tables. Press enter. Is it gonna pull? Yep, there we go. So this is a relatively excellent. So we have user, we have columns, privileges. This is for the SQL. Excellent. So we got a lot of tables here. Let's see what we can do. Let's see what we can do with this user. Probably there's bound to be something there. I mean, you can go ahead and check the others as well. But usually, if there's something that says user, password, or something of a kind, go and check it out. You can feel f I personally would go through every single thing once I fetch the database because you never know how somebody's gonna name something, what sort of credentials are they, what sort of identification are they going to use. They might as well name this table user to maybe not this particular one, but on the sites, on the web servers elsewhere, they can put their usernames and passwords in a database called, I don't know, Santa Claus under a table called Wooden Door, pretty much. So once you have it, invest a little bit more time and go through these tables, go through all the databases, go through all of their tables, and go through all the contents of the tables, try to figure out, try to see, even though some of it is encrypted, fine, okay, store it, maybe decrypt it later, but go through all of it, have a look at what is within those databases, because as I said, they can, a lot of things can be just named differently and you might skip it thinking it's nothing. Okay, so let's change it up, just change the paste a little bit. Let's say T and for table, and let's say that I have one table user and dash dash column press enter. Let's see, what do we get? Do you want to use common column existence check? Sure, why not? Let's see what happens. Please enter the number of threads. This is a pretty small one, but the more threads you enter, the faster it's gonna go, but the risk of detection is higher, I guess. I don't know, let's see if we can support 4 threads on this virtual machine. Apparently we can. I could have probably told it more, but it doesn't really matter. This is gonna run for a while, and then we're gonna see the contents of the table. Basically we'll see the columns and we'll see what's actually written in them. Anyway, until I will pause the tutorial here, I will let it finish, and then we'll pick up where we left off in the follow-up tutorial. Until then, I bid you all farewell and wish you a lot of luck with this.